7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Let's start right out. Hey, what happened?
There we go. There we are. Hi, guys.
Hello.
How you doing?
Good, you?
I'm good.
Good.
See ya.
Good.
Welcome to the program. My name is Dean.
Unvaccinated?
Nope. Two C's. I just go with vax now anytime I type it. I'm like anti-vax because, and it's funny because so many people are typing vax, V-A-X-X.
Yeah.
Or V-A-X. That depending on how much you type it, your phone will literally go, I think you mean this with one X, or I think you mean this with two X's. It's fucking wild. But I'm happy that they let me type in anti-vax and I don't have to keep going back to fix it. That's the thing that bothers me. It's like when you're trying to type anti-vax, like today I typed in anti-vax fucker and it came out anti-vox ducker.
Yeah, the duck thing
I was like,
always
not the
me.
Same thing. I don't think you're getting
anti-vax
that.
Fucker, not ducker. And it's not vox, it's vax.
He is a vaccine ducker.
Fucker. Yeah, lots of those. We're going to get to them today. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whenever you're listening to us, watching us. You can get us on Apple Podcasts. You can get us on Apple Podcasts. You can get us on Spotify. We're also on YouTube, Dean Blundell Show on YouTube and Dean Blundell TV on Twitch, which is a lot of fun. If you're on Twitch, you can interact with us there and comment and stuff like that. So we appreciate it. Special thank you to our sponsors today. I want to thank Easy Auto Financial. If you're looking for a car, turnkey, doesn't cost you a dime. If you got bad credit, good credit, doesn't matter. They get everybody a vehicle and they send you to find it. The easiest way to do it, no cost, easyautofinancial.ca. Check them out today. Also, our friends at Domination, domination.com, DMNTN.com. Try them out. They are free to try. And if you do content like this, instead of doing like promos and stuff like that, you just feed a file into, you get like 72 promos in like 20 minutes. That's it. Not even. I think it's like 5 minutes. So super easy to do. Try domination.com if you produce content. Also, a hello and special hi to my friend Ed at Ed's Fine Imports. He just packaged up Gitch for both of you guys, so I need your address. Gitch, luxury branded underwear pouch. Ooh. In the front, boxer briefs that breathe. Yeah.
Mail.
Four pairs each. Got you all black, by the way. You got black Gitch because I know there's probably some staining. Some staining.
I'm more of a black Gitch guy.
Yeah.
All right. Where do you want me to send it?
I love how you guys have already sent me your addresses. Like, anytime there's free shit.
This is the 16th time we've done this.
I live in the sticks. The only underwear they have here are tidy whiteys and something made out of bear fur. I don't even know what it is.
Yeah, well, that sounds like it feels pretty good, actually. But as soon as I said we've got Gitch for you guys from Ed's Fine Imports, all of a sudden the addresses appear. I know now where James lives. It's awesome. But anyway, we've got Gitch from Ed's.
34 large package.
Yeah, right. Jesus Christ. I need the medium waist, but the large package. Do they have any of those? I was waiting for that line.
It's not my dick. It's my balls.
Edgefineimports.com.
Thank you, James.
Also, Blue Microphones were officially sponsored and brought to you by our friends at Blue. Go to bluemike.com or at Blue Microphones on Twitter. Check them out today. We're using the Blue Yeti X's here. We've got our headphones, MoFi headphones, and James is just kind of piecing it together because what works for James. So fuck off, everybody. Anyway.
Love you.
How are we? I'm in Toronto. James is in Killaloo, and Lochlin is in
Killaloo.
Edmonton, Alberta, ladies and gentlemen. Woo. Edmonton, Alberta.
Yo, that province Alberta. Is sick, yo.
Sick, yo.
So
if only, hold it. If only a couple of guys, including you, three guys, had been screaming that pretending that fucking COVID was over just so you could go to the Stampede, get reelected. Hang on. Just if only everybody said it was a terrible idea and everybody's going to get sick and ICU's going to get full. If only everybody hadn't said that. Yesterday, Jason Kenney, your premier, says, we're fucked. 130% occupancy in our ICUs. Now, breaking proof of vaccination program announced in Alberta. State of emergency declared. Let's have a look at cases by province. On you can add all the cases up across Canada. We don't even compare to Alberta today. That's a collective, by the way. I saw that yesterday. We've been tweeting about it today. Our friend, our buddy of mine was like, hey, listen, you got to do this thing about the greatest summer ever. Because remember that? They were saying it was going to be the greatest summer in Alberta's history. Do you
remember? And it was. It was pretty decent, actually.
Pretty good marketing campaign for a second.
So here's
how you doing, Alberta? How you doing, Mr. Alberta? How you feeling right now?
So here's the thing. I realize that this is not the politically correct thing to say, but this was all part of Kenny's plan. You're on your fucking own, Alberta. That I know it wasn't actually advertised as such outside of this podcast.
You got to stop with this. You got to stop. I mean, no matter how much you try to massage the tip of this disgusting wiener, it is still a disgusting
wiener.
Anytime
he preambles, he was like, listen, I'm not trying to be politically. Oh, he's totally about to be politically incorrect.
Listen, it does sound a little insensitive because people are getting sick, but
I don't care.
This was the plan. The plan was you're on your own, fuckers. No, we gave you every opportunity to get vaccinated, and look what happened. It happened exactly what he knew. It was Kenny's not a dumb guy. He knew this would happen. He knew this would happen.
Why did he do it?
Yeah, because great question, James.
Like, I can't even see a viable strategy concept for doing that.
Because James, you fucked him up.
All kidding aside,
one question. Why then?
All kidding aside, this has been bungled right from the beginning, and the problem is that one doctor. I said this last week on the podcast. That one doctor in Edmonton who works in the ICU department was saying, listen, Alberta might be done with COVID, but COVID isn't done with Alberta, and things are just going to continue to get worse. Right. And, and it did. And we probably should have done a lot of things differently. Unfortunately, we're not led by the smartest people in the world. And this isn't a conservative liberal thing. This isn't an NDP Green Party thing.
I'm glad you said that.
We do not have public officials that are making the best decisions. And I don't know what the answer is. I think because he was getting so much pressure. The thing with Kenny is Kenny believes, and he might not admit this on public airways, but he believes that the severe right, the strong right-leaning side of Alberta, alt-right, and the religious right got him in.
And fucking crackerjacks. Right. Yeah.
They're the loudest in his ear about locked towns and vaccine passports. And I don't know why we continue from our political leaders continue to ignore the middle. I am not liberal. I'm not conservative. I'm smack dab in the middle with the two of you guys, and we are on an island. We are on our own, but it's the biggest
common
island.
Sense island is common yeah. sense yeah. island. It's the quietest yeah. island. Yeah,
but aren't you?
And I'm telling you, at some point, listen, the vote compass told me to lean to PPC. It doesn't mean I'm going to, because
I pissed all over my computer.
Webpage is a
liberal. So
yeah. The CBC webpage, that's a communist webpage. No wonder they told me to vote PPC. So anyway, we're fucked, and people are dying, and it is what it is. And I feel here's who I feel bad for, because you're not going. I played a call that we had, our break that we did from a text that we got this morning from a guy named Chad. And that's, I can't make this shit up.
An anti-vaxxer named Chad.
He believes what he believes. You're not going to convince him otherwise. He doesn't believe that he's clearly not vaccinated, and he doesn't believe that being unvaccinated has had any impact whatsoever on the numbers here in Alberta.
It is a combination of things, but can I just quickly intercede with a couple of morsels, if you will? I like calling these things morsels. Traditionally in digital media, we call them assets. I just call them morsels of goodness. This is Jason Kenney, your premier, the week the stampede started. Okay. The week this was the week
Please have a hat on.
Bud, would I ever disappoint you with any kind of video ever. Of course he's got a fucking hat on.
Awesome. Thank you.
This is Jason Kenney right before
standing. Vaccine passports for those individuals unwilling to be vaccinated.
Opposed. And we've been very clear from the beginning that we will not facilitate or accept vaccine passports, and that, in fact, we regard, I believe that they would, in principle, contravene the Health Information Act and also possibly the Freedom of Information and Protection of Privacy Act. We also amended the Public Health Act to remove the 110-year-old power allowing Alberta to force people to be inoculated. So these folks who are concerned about mandatory vaccines have nothing to be concerned about, and there will be no vaccine passports in Alberta.
And will the provincial government act on behalf of Alberta citizens if the federal government seeks to impose such restrictions?
Yes.
Okay. So that was the week. He was like, there's no such thing as COVID anymore. We got vaccines. Everybody back to it. We're not contact tracing. We're not doing anything. Nothing. No, don't need to isolate. You guys are quadruple any other fucking more than that. Quadruple, more than quadruple any other province. So that, and he says, no vaccine mandates, no nothing. Fuck you guys. Let me just offer this as an olive branch on behalf of every single fucking politician that isn't worth the truth he says he's trying to tell. This is him yesterday. This is your boy yesterday, dude. This was yesterday. This is great.
I do not say not this, my boy.
Way, to stigmatize people, but we all need to understand that the decision.
I have more in common with the guy in the back, and I don't know sign language. Choice.
It has real consequences for our whole society.
Did you notice the sign language guy? He's got that look on his face like, fuck, I don't even want to be here. Embarrassing that I'm attached
I was
to this.
The 15th the deaf community is going to
fucking
called.
Hate me.
Yeah.
Were you really? Oh, yeah, I was no. Like, nobody else. Everybody else said no. Anyway, listen to this. Oh, wait, this is his caveat. This is him yesterday saying vaccine mandates are definitely coming. And by the way, the province of Alberta, 66% fully vax rates, the lowest in Canada by far. So have a listen
and
to the rest of this.
Of our hospitals to cope. COVID is hitting Alberta harder than anywhere in Canada because we have the lowest rate of vaccination in Canada. That is why the government has reluctantly decided to adopt the restriction exemption program, a proof of vaccination program for participation in certain discretionary activities that have a higher risk of viral transmission. But with unvaccinated patients overwhelming our hospitals, this is now the only responsible choice that we have. We believed that we could prudently move away from addressing COVID as a pandemic and towards an endemic. It is now clear that we were wrong. And for that, I apologize.
Oh, he sounds so sincere
nice
when he apologizes. Like,
what a nice
so,
thing.
So warm.
Hey. You got for like the next, you're in it till Christmas, by the way. You're fucked till Christmas. This happened to Ontario last year. You are fucked until after Christmas. And he said, sorry. So everything's yeah. Okay. That's cool.
Well, and they can't spit it out. They can't do it. Eh? Like he just can't say vaccine passport. It's hanging there. It's a yeah. Certificate. It's a piece of paper and
it's a risk analysis portal.
It'll be,
it's actually the smartest thing he did.
Volunteer
we all agreed
measure.
At one point, right? That it was a bad and, name passport.
Yeah.
Every yeah, but what call it what it
what,
is.
Who cares? Who cares we're what it's called though? Like, fuck, it's the only thing that's saving everybody at this point. Like, you know, the people that have had vaccine passports, like Quebec's had them for a month. A month. They're fucking sailing in Quebec. We've had them for a couple weeks. Well, they come into effect on the 22nd, which is what, to a Wednesday? I think it's Wednesday yeah. They come into effect. I downloaded mine this week. Feel really good, plucky about doing business. Everybody's fully vaccinated. I think Ontario's around 77.4% as of this morning. It was the last time I checked it. You guys are at 66. And nothing is in place. Nothing.
Yeah.
So if this isn't, it doesn't just end with an announcement. That's the thing, right? It doesn't just end with an announcement, but the fallout from this has been fucking fascinating to me. Fascinating. And let me explain what.
Okay,
go ahead,
sorry,
James.
Go ahead, please. No, I just thought, are they still not incentivizing Albertans with like.
Oh, yeah.
That, oh, yeah. There's.
Yeah.
I, like,
they're
I,
doing everything.
There was a conversation
millions
about a lottery,
to get
and then that went away, yeah, yeah. And then there was a $100 thing, but I'm not sure if you get that. Like, I don't know.
Opiate overdoses will probably spike after they give away their $100 to all the newly vaccinated folk.
Yeah. Yeah. Huge. Well, but this is the fallout, which is why it bothers me. Well, it doesn't bother me. It's kind of exciting because right before the election started, do you remember when Aaron O'Toole? Do you remember when Aaron O'Toole put out that video of him talking about how Alberta did it better than anyone else. Do you remember that? Because I do. And well. I remember I tweeted after he put the video out. I'm like, dude, we all have fucking Google. We all know that Alberta sucks the tit when it comes to being able to protect people. And they're not taking any of this seriously. But if remember, Aaron O'Toole is not just getting dragged. He's been asked 11 times about this interview or this commercial that he put out today. Just today on the campaign trail, hasn't answered any of it.
Premier Kenney has navigated this COVID-19 pandemic far better than the federal government has.
COVID is hitting Alberta harder than anywhere in Canada.
Premier Kenney has navigated this COVID-19 pandemic far better than the federal government has.
It is now clear that we were wrong.
And when it comes to getting our country back on track, the federal conservatives can learn a lot from our UCP cousins.
COVID is hitting Alberta harder than anywhere in Canada.
Well, the numbers continue to be staggering in Alberta as well, Heather. Yesterday, the province added nearly 1,600 new cases of COVID-19 into its count.
It is now clear that we were wrong.
We were wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah. It, you know what? I don't even know what to say anymore. I mean,
every politician has done this amazing, you know, week-long trip down one side of an issue only to like flip and flop back to the other side of the issue. Ford did it a number of times last year. Trudeau's done it a number of times where they just have this great idea and it's usually a gamble and then it flies in their face and then they give their little half-ass apology. I don't even know what to say anymore. It was almost like he was living 6 months in the past and he was like, the Florida numbers, they were good when they stopped doing shit. And then he forgot that it spiked again. And then same with Texas, right?
The crazy part about where we're at right now, it isn't that we have our ICUs full here in Alberta or that we have record COVID numbers. I think actually we have worse numbers than we did last summer, if I'm not mistaken. The crazy part about it is that there's still a large chunk of the Alberta population that is refusing to get vaccinated and refuses to believe that this is still a thing. Like that's the scary thing about it, right? Like,
They think that Kenny's announcement was just more bullshit, more governmental bullshit, because
I don't know how they, I don't know how they manipulate that into their narrative, but they seem to figure it out.
Is it rural folks? Mostly because, I mean, I live in a rural area in Ontario, and even when it was going crazy, my life never changed at all, right? So if I was just that much if a donkey kicked me in the head, I probably would think that there was no pandemic, right?
Honestly, I think there is an element of that. I think also, too, there is this lack of empathy for loss of life if it doesn't add up to what they think it should be. Based on the level of conversation that we're having about it. So every time they tune in the radio, every time they turn on the television, we're going on and on and on and on and on about COVID, about the pandemic, about people dying. And they go, what do you mean? Fuck, there's only 1,200 fucking people that died. 99% of the population is surviving this. Why am I locked down? Why are you making me wear a mask? Guys are not wearing seatbelts. They're the ones that go find a bar, and you can still find them in Alberta where there's ashtrays and you can smoke. Like, you know what I mean? Like there's this and
same mentality, you know, and it's funny because you talked about, you know, the kind of person that still doesn't, that's okay. That accepts like a certain amount of death. Right. And I found it fucking fascinating. I really did. I found it fucking fascinating. That each one of these pieces of shit, anti-militant, anti-vax, anti-science, dumber than a fucking rock, moron, complained when we pulled out of Afghanistan after Canada lost several hundred people. They complained more about the death toll in Afghanistan than the 30,000 people here that died of COVID.
That's an excellent
Like if you think
we
about where your price
29 lives in Afghanistan and fuckers pull out.
Waste of life. Are you fucking kidding me right now?
So much.
30,000 fucking people died in this country. Over 30,000 of this. This has killed more people than the First and Second World War in Canada, or Canadians. And you're standing there going, Afghanistan, but this isn't real. This death doesn't matter to you. Like, that's when you calculate human cost at a basic level, none of what they say makes sense. Therefore, those people in Alberta, the people in every province that are militantly anti-vax,
they're all over.
They think they have the answers. They don't. And I've been saying it for years, that kind of lack of empathy for human life, only in as much as it affects them, just them. They don't deserve the same rights and privileges we have in this country. They don't.
They don't think it impacts human life, though. That's the problem, right? They're not getting it because the pandemic is fake and the vaccines don't work, right? Like right. So they don't even think that they're doing what you're saying they're doing. So they're approaching it like you're a sheeple and they're not.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That's all.
Well,
they
they're
need
dying
to.
And we're not. And yeah. Alberta's in lockdown and we're not.
I watched
I'm
an
healthy,
interview.
They're not.
I watched an interview right. with a nurse today from the emergency. I can't remember. Anyway, it doesn't matter. But she's responsible for dealing with COVID patients when they come in and then assessing them and deciding whether or not they need to go to the next level. So she's an emergency nurse. And so she's sending people to the ICU and she's like, the thing that's disheartening about what's happening right now is we're all exhausted and we're losing patients. And I swing back and forth between anger for these idiots not taking the vaccine to what should be my proper response, which is empathy and feeling sorry for these fucking idiots because they got caught up. Somebody at work, a family member, somebody got into their head, too much time on Facebook. What it doesn't matter what the reason is and why they didn't get vaccinated.
Jesus.
And now I got to send them to ICU. And there's a chance they may never get out of the hospital. Like they're going to die here.
Oh, well.
And but
you just see said what you're doing. These people have no regard for human life. They're going to die in the hospital.
Well, listen.
It's contagious,
right? How like, long do you hold it, Jimmy?
She's having the same
Jamesy?
Struggle we are, though. That's the thing.
Right, I know.
And everybody's
but like, how
having
do we
that
protect,
struggle.
But listen. It's been 2 years of saying the same thing. It's like singing the fucking hits every single time you go out. Like, I'm tired of singing the hits. I'm tired of fucking making sense. I'm tired of telling the truth. I'm tired of saying, oh, we need to have empathy for these people when they're standing in front of hospitals, preventing people from getting fucking chemo. Tired
imagine
of people telling
nurse,
us that 99% survivable. Team. Tired of it. Oh, no, those are special people. That's why we're not nurses or doctors, by the way.
They get into that field because of a mindset. Because of a strong sense and a commitment to save other people's lives, and they are conflicted now, right? I mean, she was telling a story. She's like, "This has been really hard on all of us." She goes, "I sent a pregnant woman to the ICU this week, and she's probably going to die."
Yeah,
a pregnant woman who is not 50, who's not 60, who's not 70, who's not 80. The only condition she had was she's carrying. She refused to get the vaccine because somebody had convinced her that it wasn't going to be good for her kid.
Thanks a lot, Bob.
Yeah.
Right? You know what I mean? And
Yeah.
No,
I mean, there's stories like that all over the place. It's not just
these people's minds.
I know.
In the moment.
I know, but what you just said is the whole problem, right? It's parents, whether they're expecting or they got young kids, passing on that idiocy to their children. And then, of course, people getting sick and then an unborn baby dying. No matter how you feel, it's tragic, right? Any death is tragic. I care about human life, but I can't physically be empathetic to anybody who militantly prevents other people from doing something healthy for themselves because they think that they shouldn't have to submit to any laws in this country other than the laws that govern their own freedom. I can't, and I won't, because I don't have the brain power to do it. I just don't anymore. I don't have the, you know, testicular fortitude or intestinal fortitude, if you want to take it out of the misogyny arena. I don't have that in me anymore. I don't have the brain power to go, oh, well, you know, let's all rally around the guy who refused health care, who said it was bullshit. And the second he got a temperature of 105 and a tickle in his throat and some pain in his nose and some achy ears, he then decided to submit fully to the medical process. I don't think those people deserve the same frontline treatment as people who are like, hey, listen, I'm double vaxxed and I'm sick. I need to come in. Well, fuck, front of the line. Let's go. You've observed your civic duty to the Republic of Canada. You've done exactly what you should have done. Is it sad? Of course it is. Obviously, everybody cares about life and death. We all do. But if my son, and I got three beautiful boys, and they all great listeners, and I'm really lucky I've got a great relationship with them, and I think I've trained them pretty well to kind of accept what comes your way and be able to make adult decisions in the minute so that you're not just ruined for life and fighting against everything. That's what this is. It's what this is. Anyway, fucking fascinating. I feel sorry for the people of Alberta. I really do.
I had a caller a couple of weeks back, and it was a guy that listens to us pretty religiously. And he's actually got a podcast. He's into barbecuing, and he works for a company that in the summer, what are they? I don't know. It doesn't matter. In the winter, they clear snow, right? And in the summer, he does something else. He transitions
landscaping.
Well, probably landscaping, but I think it's something else. Like, anyway, it doesn't matter. His wife's pregnant, and he calls up and he goes, you know, I listen to you guys every day, and you're kind of talking about the unvaccinated, but I gotta tell you, man, I just don't trust it, and I won't let my wife get vaccinated. And the whole time I'm watching that story of that woman, the nurse, emergency nurse here in Edmonton on CBC, talk about the whole time I'm sitting there going, that guy told his wife he wasn't going to let her get vaccinated.
Probably. These are things that we can't stop, though. Like, I think people think that
child is dying in the ICU right now. And guess what? It's not hundreds. It's not thousands. It's not a million people. But 24 people died yesterday. 24 people died. And you can break that down to a percentage, and maybe you can live with that. Maybe you can deal with that. But for me, I keep hearing these stories of these, like this one person. And that one person isn't 1%. That one person is somebody's daughter with a grandchild in her. Like, it's fucked. It's fucked that we're at where we're at, and that we're having fights on social media.
But whether or not life matters.
And like
that's the crazy part,
it's
fellas.
It's fucked, man. It's fucked.
Like we're
it's
having fucked. These conversations now, and we're trying to bring it to the forefront. We're trying to have these great, you know, we're trying to embrace all different parts of it. But the more we go down these roads, I always arrive at one thing, right? And Locke, you did a great job explaining it. That one person. It could be that woman. It could be someone else. But the fact that these people, meaning people that are in the hospital, not these people like those people, but these people that are getting incredibly sick and are not vaccinated and refused it. And the fact that every single region that has not adopted a very strict regime or a very strict set of processes and circumstances to go with the vaccine are getting sicker and dying and filling up hospitals and canceling like elective surgery. There's a dude in Alberta, he sent me, I think I put it out last week, and it went viral. The scan of the tumor of his brain, the X-ray, the CT scan.
At home waiting for him.
And he's like, I was supposed to go in and have this removed today. Can't do it now because the hospital's packed. ICUs are packed. And when you have brain surgery, you go immediately into the intensive care when you're done, right? Because it's touch and go. You just fucking open up a guy's head. And he can't do it. He can't do it. So like, there's so many fucking emotions that play a part of this. And the like, there's anger on behalf of regular people that have done the work because we didn't want to see that. There's sadness because the ICUs are full of people getting sick. It doesn't matter how they feel. You're right. Human life is important. But the dangerous part is a guy like myself that really does believe in the greater good and thinks there's nothing more important than human life. I also believe that death is kind of exciting and interesting, and I'm kind of looking forward to it as well. But having said all that, like, I can't get my head around the fact that there's this massive segment of this country that doesn't care about your life or my life or your neighbor's life, or really for that better matter, I mean, their parents' life or their kids' lives. And so to me, I've had to shut off.
I don't know if I think we're also desensitized because we're sitting there on the radio talking about numbers and we're talking about, you know, and then other people are regurgitating numbers. It's this, right? Like I had I'll call him an acquaintance because I'm questioning the friendship conversation now, revolving around this guy, but he was sending me daily stats just to prove to me how, when everything was locked down, just to prove to me on the radio so that I could go on. I don't know what the fuck he was doing. I did the math and I'm going on all these web pages and this is not as big a deal as they're making it sound. And they're dealing with numbers and they're looking at numbers and they're not it. And we're delivering numbers and we're talking about numbers and this percentage and that percentage. And we're not talking about the impact it's having on people's families. We're just delivering 1500 cases today. That's and people are just desensitized to it. Unless it creeps up and bites them in the ass, you're not feeling the full impact of what we're going through right now. And again, this is coming from a guy. Sorry, James, I'll finish it. This is coming from a guy that is wildly critical of the steps we've taken and not taken during the pandemic to shut us down and not shut us down. I think that's the saddest part about it, is that it's going to take us years to get to a conversation where, what mistakes were made, because we're so fucking divided and we can't even get into the same bubble to have a conversation about what they're doing that's fucking.
Yeah.
Us.
We don't have a starting point to fix the problem. You're right. Because no one's on the same page. James, sorry, go ahead.
No, it's okay. I can't remember if it was Lochlin, if it was you, or if it was Dean. I think you both probably would agree, but anyways, but one of you said recently that it was like QAnon, right? It was like Pizzagate. And that's what I think. I think less than they don't care about people is that they're gullible and they got fed stories through social media that they just gravitated to and they believe in, like, because it spoke to something that maybe a friend mentioned the week before. You know, the vaccines. What the fuck? Gullible, and I think that they had to be internet savvy, you know, because, you know, I don't know. I don't make fun of the demographic.
They're also
as being real big techies, like really.
They're also smart.
They're also looking. They're looking for information that automatically feeds their prejudice, whichever way they're leaning, one way or the other, right?
They don't type in unbiased this or unbiased that. They type in stuff like, "Is the vaccine going to kill me?" They type in arguments against vaccines.
Yeah,
we do it on both sides.
But the pro vaccine is like, Pfizer said it works. It works, guys. It works, and it's like, that's a more reasonable position than it's a big conspiracy for 5G chips to be inserted into your bloodstream via nano robots that will take your temperature and send it to marketers or whatever the fuck they think, right? So but the other side is a little less controversial, but it feeds that one that QAnon kind of side when we say, you know what? I'm going to take the vaccine. Pfizer said it was approved. They said that the testing went well, and then, you know, vaccine mixing. You know, the contradiction. I'm still going to take it.
So much contradiction.
Yeah, and so so even stuff that isn't really about what they believe, but just about the vaccines and what the pro-vaccine crowd believes, they use that as a thing that they can insert into their narrative and say, these are sheeple. They're just blindly taking something that's not approved, all that.
Just to add to what you're saying, 100% agree. Fuck, I love when we all agree. It's the best. It's because then it means we're all right, right? Yeah. That's what it means. But just to add to your thing, these people are Googling for, not for talking points, they're Googling so they can dunk on scientists online. Like, that's the fucking crazy part. It's like, you know, I'm going to Google something because some scientist said get vaccinated, and I'm going to go find another scientist with an expert, and I'm going to take that expert opinion that's fucking totally wrong, and I'm not going to use it to educate myself.
Yeah.
I'm not going to read the whole thing. I'm going to find a piece in there that justifies this, and then I'm going to fucking dunk on people all day long. And it's like guys in Alberta or guys in northern Manitoba going, 22 followers. I just read this thing from some crackpot in the States. He's a doctor. It says MD. Like, and there's a chiropractor in the States that's doing this. It's like writing different shit about the vaccine. You're a fucking chiropractor. And so what happens is all these people will go around and go, hey, listen, this MD said this. And they're not using it to educate themselves. That's the fucking difference. The difference is
they're using it as ammunition. To present their side, which they've already decided is the right side of things. Well, we're doing it too. Both sides are doing it, and it's not helping. It's not getting us to the conversation we need to have. And look at how desperate everybody is on both sides to find things to present as these sort of flagpoles, this tent pole shit to build our narrative around. Like that fucking Nicki Minaj tweet. My cousin's friend's balls swelled up. Tucker Carlson has spent all week.
On her on the cousin's friend's balls.
A fucking Nicki Minaj tweet.
Yes, sir.
And he's pivoted from that to a discussion about the dangers of vaccine on our sperm. Like, what the fuck? You're using
a Nicki Minaj
tweet.
Yeah, you want to upset a guy, tell him it's his balls are going to be affected by anything. Don't do that. Your balls are going to get affected. You're like, holy fuck, I'm not eating cheese anymore.
And now,
don't eat bread. Your balls will explode. No more bread for me because it's about my balls. Sorry. And it's not just, I'm going to play the Nicki Minaj thing again. So this is Tucker Carlson this week. This was his expert opinion on Nicki Minaj's tweet, which has, and we'll get to a couple of videos here. But this is concurrently when you see this guy and you put it all together. Then you kind of get that he's a fucking lying bag of shit.
Huge rap artist. Not sure there's much overlap between her audience and this one, but our producers assure us she's one of the biggest in the world. 100 million records, assuming records still exist. And she has an opinion on vaccine mandates, which is still technically allowed in this country. So ahead of the Met Gala tonight, she tweeted about it. She's skeptical. She wrote this, quote, "They want you to get vaccinated for the Met. If I get vaccinated, it won't be for the Met. It'll be once I feel I've done enough research. I'm working on that now. In the meantime, be safe. Wear the mask with two strings that grip your face and head, not that loose one," end quote. And then in another tweet, she added this. She said that her cousin in Trinidad, quote, "won't get the vaccine because his friend got it and became impotent. His testicles became swollen. His friend was weeks away from getting married. Now that girl called off the wedding. So just pray on it and make sure you're comfortable with your decision, not bullied."
Then
after your balls hurt, that's it. It's over.
Hold it. Just to your point, this is the fucking white knight of the anti-vax movement. This piece of shit, fucker Carlson. Then last night he puts on an out of work comedian that used to be on Saturday Night Live named Jim Breuer. Do you remember Jim Breuer, Goat Boy from Saturday Night Live?
Yeah.
So he's got Jim Breuer on the show last. Yeah, exactly.
I saw him open up for Metallica.
He's an awful fucking comedian. Awful
he's
comedian.
He's got a couple of funny bits.
So the reason why he's on Tucker
Down syndrome too. Let's be honest, his eyes are all crooked. Still.
Well, let's not go there.
I think it's substance.
If I take my glasses off,
trouble.
Yeah.
So this is.
You don't need much room.
You take your glasses off. You might drink the turpentine instead of the Bud Light. So
this is Jim Breuer. This was last night's expert guest on
what is happening.
Watch this. This is fucking unbelievable.
When our leader put that out there and pointed the finger, like, we're the demons, I'm not vaccinated. I had COVID. You're not going to tell me about my body. I know my body. I know my morals. I know my faith. You don't come telling me and threaten me.
He looks great.
You know my faith. You know my superstitions. You know, like, that should get me out of trouble. I believe in Thor.
I believe your question prior to
this
that
is crazy,
clip was,
this is crazy.
What is happening?
He pivoted from a Nicki Minaj tweet to an interview with Jim Breuer.
Yeah, about the vaccine.
And isn't he prime time?
Yeah.
Isn't Nicki Minaj? Isn't Nicki Minaj the one who bragged about how she used to drug men and steal their shit?
No, Cardi B. That was Cardi B, I think.
Oh,
where they used to. Yeah, where she used to. She was. Was she a hooker? Was Cardi B a hooker?
Cardi B was an escort.
Yeah. So she would. Yeah, she would douse her. And it's actually kind of brilliant. I mean, I'm not condoning it here, but
she does her privates with some
stuff.
Who's
going to phone the cops and go, I got a hooker and she stole my Rolex
and I drugged me and stole.
I think she roofied me.
Yeah. Technically he didn't pay for it.
No wonder they got away with her in so long. What's your name, sir?
Never mind. Mr. Rick never Bond. Mind.
I'll be good.
That's who I am.
It's only a $40,000 watch.
It's only a fucking heirloom for my granddad. Don't worry about it.
I don't want to be condoning that kind of behavior, but someone needed to point out how
still
brilliant
funny.
It is.
But aren't these last two interviews that we just played, aren't they just all you need to know? About what side you should be on.
About like, what whether like or watching, not Tucker Carlson. It's
like if
should
I'm an
jump out
like if
building,
I'm an anti-vaxxer, if I'm an anti yeah, if I'm an anti-vaxxer and I'm like I love Tucker, right? Like if I'm an anti because everybody does, because he's fully vaccinated. But if I'm an anti-vaxxer and I go, Tucker's gonna be on tonight and he's gonna talk about this vaccine that's making balls swell up, I'd be like, turn it on and go, I'm an anti-vaxxer, but Nikki Minaj, I mean, her biggest song was about sucking a massive black guy's dick. Like, that's like the Anaconda.
What's that song? I don't know that one.
I think it's called Anaconda. wow, and I'm like,
the way that
I don't
she
know, like,
didn't make it obvious.
Yeah, I know. It was in her lyrics, not being racist. I'm just saying that was like, that's what she was singing. It was her biggest song in the world. And then the next guy, she's like, today we had to talk about spike proteins. We've got Goat Boy, like.
But do you know what is? You ever seen those
hear
programs
me out. Hear me
where
out,
they
though.
Talk
hear
about
me
artificial
out.
Intelligence and developing
he believes
artificial?
In God. Okay, bring him on.
Yeah.
Yes. Go ahead, Jamesy.
No, just how they develop artificial intelligence and they assign AI like an obituary or something, and it will be like Brenda had husband. She brings with her death. Like it's all mangled and it's all weird because they go by keywords and stuff.
Yeah.
That's what it looks like. That's what having Jim Breuer on to talk about this as some sort of qualified expert, it looks like AI is trying to figure out the good content for COVID news. And they're just not hitting it yet.
Slapping it together. Yeah.
At some point though, even Tucker has to go and turn to the camera and go, I'm sorry.
Never.
He turns to the camera and goes, I fucking can't believe these people are falling for this.
Yeah,
it's been years.
That's what he
listen
does.
You fucking idiots, like get a life, go watch something else, right? Isn't there a baseball game on? I think the Yankees are playing. I got Jim Breuer coming up to, and he's my expert tonight on vaccines.
Goat Boy.
And I have a gun in my bedside drawer and I've been licking the end of it every night for a month.
Anaconda.
That's what I want to hear Tucker Carlson say. That's the only thing.
I've been
contemplating.
It was so bad that they had. Here's the testicular. Like I found video of them protesting on behalf of this guy's nuts in Trinidad.
What brings you here?
We are here because CDC has been lying to us. For so long.
Nicki Minaj fans in Atlanta say they trust her medical advice about the COVID-19 vaccine.
Nicki, the queen of rap.
And Nicki, you need to stop. Like, you got to look at that and go.
She's queen of rap. I believe the queen of rap. I want medical advice from the fucking queen of rap.
Ah, yeah. And then the health minister, we played this yesterday, the health minister of Trinidad was like, we checked it out. We shut the whole fucking country down for like
this
2 days. We can't find.
One of the reasons we could not respond yesterday in real time to Miss Minaj is that we had to check and make sure that what she was claiming was either true or false. And unfortunately, we wasted so much time yesterday running down this false claim. It is. As far as we know, at this point in time, there has been no such reported either side effect or adverse event.
She should be in jail. Like honestly, there should be some form of jail or punishment for that kind of stupidity.
Well, isn't there a law against walking into a fucking movie theater screaming fire in the middle of a movie?
There's a literal law.
Yeah. Well, that's you can't yell fire.
Free speech has limits, and that's the example they always use.
The guy's trying not to laugh, right? Like he's can hear. Laughing. He's like. He's looking at his partners in that, like that whole press conference. We showed a big chunk of it yesterday. He's looking at him like, can you fucking believe that we had to waste a whole day on a Nicki Minaj tweet? I don't even know who the fucking woman is. Like,
these are doctors that have gone to school for 20 years and they're hunting down.
And why did she get 150,000 fucking retweets? We don't know. And we can't find the guy with the huge testicles.
A celebrity could type CQ8 and they'll get like 50,000 retweets and likes.
So, yeah. Weird. Yeah, you gotta wonder though, like bringing it back home, because O'Toole did the same thing, right? O'Toole did the same thing when he said, "Alberta, you're the best. You guys nailed this." He lied, like he's still doing it.
When's that video from?
It was Fat O'Toole. So it was prior to Fat O'Toole was like probably I would say
November last year.
No, June. June of this year.
Okay. I mean,
how could he even tell?
June of this year?
June of this year.
I thought he started working out in January. Maybe it didn't really start to take impact.
I think he really didn't swear off the cakes until June, maybe. I'm not sure. But like this guy was pretending it wasn't an issue as well. I mean, he lied and he's still lying. Like he's walking around. He wants to be the prime minister neck and neck with Justin Trudeau, like neck and neck. And he's still not talking about the vaccine. He's still not talking about mandates. He's still not saying, no, it's a choice. Like, he's still doing it.
Max Bernier has caused so many politicians in this country to adjust and do something stupid because that's what they're worried about.
Liberals are right now, too. Yeah.
Liberals are, but the conservatives are certainly. Kenny, that's all a reaction to this group that is splintered away from normally voting conservative, voting PPC, according to the polls. And they're afraid, and they have no idea what to do with it.
There's a desperation in the faces of not so much O'Toole because he doesn't have as much to lose, but you can see the desperation in Trudeau's face right now.
Oh yeah,
and he's gone from being on the offensive to being on the defensive, and it's been this gradual sort of progress. But you can see it in his language, you can see it in his face, you can just tell. Like, and maybe you're right. Maybe there is, because there is this growing wave of PPC support, right?
Well, also, Dean, you said, I mean, when Dean slams anti-vaxxers, I don't have a problem with it, because Dean is like a citizen and he's a podcaster and he's a, you know, great personality and he's funny. So fucking do it. Like, that's fine. But when Justin Trudeau stands on a stage and with a very serious look says, I want to do what's best for people who believe in vaccines. And then he turns and dramatically goes, Aaron O'Toole wants to please the anti-vaxxers. And it's like, holy shit. Yeah. Like if you say shit like that, you are being Donald Trump light, at least, right? Because you're othering people. And it's just like, you can be mad at them.
For the last couple of weeks, James. That's one of many examples.
That was just
those
people.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh, dude, I mean, like we're carving the conservatives, we're carving the PPC, and I don't even like fucking talking about different parties. Like, I put out a tweet today, like, who are you going to vote for? 40% of the people said Trudeau, like 30% said O'Toole, and the rest was Jagmeet and a little bit of other, right? Like, because I just wanted to see, how are you feeling? What are we doing? How are we feeling? And I've already voted. I think I told you guys this. I voted the other day. I voted for Jagmeet Singh. And I phoned my dad this morning, and I'm talking to him about it. And he's like, hey, did you vote? And I'm like, yeah, who'd you vote for? He told me. And he goes, who'd you vote for? I go, Jagmeet. He's like, you a commie? Wow. He goes, are you fucking serious? He didn't say fuck, but he says, are you serious? I go, yeah. He goes, tell me why. Which I thought was great. Like, great question. Why did you vote for this guy? I said, well, listen. Yeah. Aaron O'Toole doesn't believe people should have to get vaccinated in the middle of a fucking pandemic. Also, he can't stop lying his dick off, never answers any questions. And his goal is to serve the Sky Daddy Jesus Christ. It's not to serve the people of this country. at Justin Trudeau is a false flag himself. He campaigned on a whole bunch of stuff he do for the indigenous people, did none of it. Now he's tying him up in court. So fuck him. He's an actor, doesn't do what he says he's going to do. None of that stuff. Jagmeet kind of said, yeah, I'm here at this old folks home. We got to do something for long-term care. I like that. Got to do something for the indigenous people of this country. You got to do something about rates, like internet rates, cell phone rates. We got to do something for the people to give them relief in different areas, like low-income housing and stuff like that. And that stuff never really mattered to me when I was acting like an entitled dick. But it matters to me now. So what I said was, I'm going to put my vote where the virtue that I hold dear is in the vote. I'm going to put it with Jagmeet. Because, as James, you could probably attest, no one's going to win a majority anyway, right? Nobody. And so doesn't matter who we get in. I have a fucking, like coalition governments or minority governments, on average, last 8 months. 8 months in the history of Canadian politics. So we'll be here again. Yeah. And at least they get the message that says, hey, you know what? We didn't want status quo to change. We're still trying to fight this again next year. Oh, dude, we might be doing it before then. That's the thing.
You think so? Right? So you think it'll be that quick, eh?
If it's the Conservatives, it probably won't be that quick. But if it's the Liberals, it'll probably be that quick, I would say. Mm-hmm. And the reason why is because the Conservatives would be sort of like the new government, while the incumbent would be like imagine how frustrated the country's going to be if like they get like 29.5% of the vote and end up getting a minority government out of it. And like, you know, that's 70% of the country not with you. Yeah. You know, so they won't have, he won't have the confidence of the House within like 8 to 10 months. And then there'll be an election within like a year.
Friend of mine who lives in BC, he sent me a DM and he said, dude, the PPC leader is going to win here. And I'm like, what? Are you kidding? I asked him to come on the pod. He's like, no fucking way. But he's got a position. He holds down a position where I understand why he doesn't want to come on. And I'm like, are you serious? Come on. That can't be true. Cause I still, to me, the PPC party is still the sperm retention warrior. By the way, my breathing exercises into my balls have been going very, very well. Again, good. I can almost swim an entire length of the pool breathing through my nuts. So it's been working. So thank you, Nicholas.
Yeah, congratulations. But yeah,
like that's, to me, that's where that's the PPC party. So
PPC is the protest vote this year.
Well, that's just it. And we are getting closer and closer in this country to doing what the United States just did 4 years ago.
Yeah.
We're at like the Tea Party stage. Burn, we're at like the Sarah Palin stage, you know, whatever year that was. And then it translated into like Trump 5 years later or 4 years later, or whatever it was. That's where
you know what? Can we switch gears? I know this is a bit of a tough transition, but I really want to talk about James's article that he wrote on the weekend. That piece that he wrote for the webpage.
Yeah, please.
Can we do that?
Sure. Yeah. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
Well, give us a break. I think this needs to start with you, James, because I think there's a lot to unpack here. But I think you need to – I'd like to understand your motivation behind it before we get into it.
Oh, okay. It was spontaneous. Like, it wasn't – it was – I was in a mood. Someone told me a long time ago when I was in high school, this writer came in to talk to the class, and he said there was no such thing as writer's block. What that is really is that you're in a certain mood, you're in a certain frame of mind, and you're trying to write something that's like the opposite of that, or just not jiving with that mood that you're in. And you should always write to reflect your mood, and then you can transition back into what you have to do. And it was just spontaneous. I didn't plan on writing it. It wasn't like, it took me like 20 minutes, you know, I just like spat it out of my fingertips as fast as I could, in a sense, like, not like I was in a rush, but it was just me talking basically. And, I don't know. I don't know why I did it. I regretted it for a second and then shook that off pretty quickly. And, you know, I got some nice messages from people who also had issues. So the piece is basically about being a fuck up your entire life and trying not to be a fuck up. Right?
Well, here's the title. You can get it at deanblundell.com. It's called Scared and Sober-ish. I believe they call it California Sober, James.
California Sober.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't even know there was a term for what James was.
Saved my life.
I haven't coined it yet. How do you spell?
But this was a big stretch for you. And when I read it, I'll be honest, I got a little misty-eyed because you shared so many important details about your life, and I'm going to read a little bit of it. It was like this for me, you said, and by extension, my partner Michelle, until December 2019. On Christmas that year, I guzzled my usually 2 to 3 bottles of wine, capped it off with a gigantic blunt, and eventually stained the white snow with bile-laced burgundy vomit, all hunched over as a gallon of wine poured out of my disgusting fat frame. Oh, yeah, I almost forgot. In 2019, my 5'6" ass weighed 205 pounds. For all intents and purposes, I was a legit fatty to go along with being a drunkard, a drug user, and a partial sex addict. I don't think I'm an actual sex addict, but if there's ever a tape of every sexual experience, it would take years to watch, and you might suggest counseling after it's over. In other words, you said, I was a great catch.
That's right.
But you poured it out. How would you summarize? And I love it because every year on my sober date, I'll like put out a little thing and encourage people to kind of, and it changes every year. But if one person reads it and they connect with it and they say, hey, you know, I feel the same way. I feel fucking allergy. I love it. I love the fact that you can connect with people like that by just being vulnerable. Right. And not many dudes are
being real.
So, yeah. How would you summarize
that?
Fucking
like, real. That's what I love intense. About it.
That's why I almost didn't publish it, though. It kind of was too real. And then I was like, well, fuck it. Like, you know, I respect writers that do the same thing. So I might as well do that as well. By the way, the excerpt that you read has caused a little bit of controversy in my life because I wrote it. That section was a little sloppy, I think, in my view, because it made it seem like up until 2 years ago, I was just doing like Hollywood lines off strippers and like, you know, and drinking like quarts of whiskey a day. Okay. So I've been with Michelle for 12 years. I would say that the guy that at the worst that you read in the piece was in up until I was like 30, 31, something like that. And you know, and so Michelle had friends in this little small town being like, I can't believe that you had to put up with that for so long. The sexcapades. How many times did he cheat on you and all this stuff? And I'm just like, oh shit.
Yeah, you didn't delineate that was your old life, or say like this was me in my 30s. And so
there wasn't
was
any
like,
separation.
Oh my god,
he's
doing that now. Yeah,
I was.
She's a trooper. She'd come home, there'd be like orgies happening, and she'd just be like, "Oh, well, you know, he's got an addiction. It's a sickness."
Yeah, he's a good man inside. He just got to let it out. Yeah.
What are you doing, James? I'm just sticking my dick in the fan.
I can make it stop.
But summarize, like I know it created some humorous problems for you and the wife. Like James,
those are really humorous. Fucking best. Yeah, thanks,
best guys.
Thanks for boiling it down to humor, Dean.
Ruining your wife's reputation in her hometown.
Yeah.
Tiny town, but like you put that out, what was the reaction? And because like you basically laid it all out, and I've never seen that from you. Like it, for the longest time, you know, we all do when we're not well, we protect this craziness, right? Like they can't let people see the crazy, but you let it out. And what was the reaction?
I don't know. Do you think I'm a person that doesn't let out the crazy on a regular basis?
I don't know where Dean was going with that, but whatever.
Like, no. You show us like it creeps out, but you'd never admitted to it before. Like this is you going, okay, here's what goes into me. This is why I'm the way I am. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, it also bothered me that I delayed for so long, like some sort of personal development. Cause I say in the piece that I would have successes. I would win awards for like documentary and a commercial, but it was all one-offs because I didn't have the discipline to see things through. And I don't know, maybe there's a part of me that also thinks that if you put it in public, then you can't, then it's even worse to fail again.
You're accountable. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Also because I was never like a Alcohol Anonymous type person. I did get a lot of people emailing me after the piece and asking me, you know, how long I was in the program, and I didn't know what they were talking about. And I was like, oh fuck. Okay. They're talking about AA. So yeah, I don't know. It's a road less traveled thing. I tell my wife this once in a while that if I woke up one day and the marriage was over and I was living like with Milhouse's dad, I would probably go back to that lifestyle. Like as much as I don't want to, it feels like I would, because I need to have like people around me that I love. I need to like feel at peace and all that kind of stuff. Because if someone shrieks, if I hear someone yelling at me, it reminds me of my stepmother. If I hear, if someone doesn't, you know, kind of gives me sort of the cold shoulder. It reminds me of my dad. Like, I have all these weird echoes, and I'm trying to, like, you know, strip away these, I don't like the word triggers, but, you know, the reminders, the things that remind you of, like, dark times and stuff. And I just, I would shudder to think what my life would be like if I woke up and had, and it was just me. And Milhouse's dad, and he does sleep in a race car. So that's good. I'd like to sleep in a race car.
You know what? I think a lot of, people, to a certain extent, they kind of suppress that crazy person, that demon in them. And I've been doing it my whole life, right? And I think maybe the stability that I've created for myself with my wife and my house and you know, a fairly regular occurring career, has kept that guy from surfacing. And so I have respect for the people that let that guy fucking go, right? Uh-huh. Like,
that guy won't come back in.
That, so I've always been, what would a fucking nut job Locke been like? Like, if I hadn't have met my wife when I was 21, locked that shit down, married her when I was 24, bought a house when I was 25, you know, got a pretty decent career, started making a little bit of enough money not enough money to get into trouble, but just enough money to support the family. What would fuck up Locke would have been like? He would have been fun. You know, it's almost a regret that died. So when it's funny because I gravitate towards guys like friends that I have let that guy out all the time, right? And then I watch from the outside looking in going, yes!
But you kind of feel like when you're doing it that you are that guy. Like you feel like that is you. That's like the true you. Right? Like, it's not, it's not.
It is. It's all of us though, James. I think we create these environments and we create these worlds that we live in. Right. And it's all a fucking charade. It is. Yeah. It's all. And whether you're fucking snorting coke off of hookers' asses or you're doing the lawn on Sunday, on some level, you've built this world and it's right. You've created this environment and it
absolutely.
Who's to say it's,
yeah,
the right one or not, right?
Well, it's subjective reality. Like, we all live in it, right? And it's really difficult, which is kind of the interesting thing about James's post. If you haven't read it, please go to dblundell.com. Scared and Soberish is the title of the post. Thanks, it's fucking fascinating because it's like you always have had self-awareness. Like, when I talked to you and we first started to get together and do stuff together and produce content, work together, you would talk very openly about your character flaws. Like, you would talk, and you still
do. I just didn't want to surprise you.
I know, but like, I don't know if it's been like a steady routine with us. I don't know what it is, but not many people have the ability to put that self-awareness into a post and go, here's the guts of me. This is what goes into me. Objectively speaking, I'm telling you all the things that I've done to try to fucking make my way through this life and how many different mistakes that I've made. And I want to lay that out for you. Nobody does that. And the people that do that on a regular basis, it's therapeutic, because what you're doing is you're saying, I want to live as an integer. Like, I want to be one thing, which is what integer means, which is the root word of integrity. And when you start doing that, you get rid of this thing called duplicity, which is this thing where we're like, we're two different people. We want to be good individuals. We want to be good men. We want to be good women, but we've got this thing inside us that says, no, 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 you need to go do something bad. Like, no, that's way more fun. Like, I still have it in me. When I quit drinking, I'm like, I still need something terrible to do. So I started smoking cigarettes at 44.
Yes.
Right? Yes. 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 Yeah. That was me.
Yeah. Shut up, Mr. Hyde. I'll get to you in a second. You know
why I haven't quit drinking? Because I know that I'll just find some fucked up thing to replace
satisfy
it with.
That right? part.
Yeah.
But what happens is when you start going, hey guys, listen, I'm just,
there's
a regular
some sobriety advice from the fucking panel, eh?
Yeah, I don't think any of us have any rights giving sobriety. Well, maybe Dean to a certain extent.
Yeah, I do, for sure.
Yeah, I started smoking at 44, and I got no issues. I'm great now.
Yeah, I don't drink or do hard narcotics anymore. I do consume about 17 pounds of mushrooms every 6 months.
I drink 100 beer a month, and that seems to work for me.
But you know what? There are groups of people who it works for. But with James, the reason why people like James, and I can't speak for you, I can speak for you. The reason why I had to fucking do something, change my perspective, and then why I like sharing my perspective all the time is
quite
it's
a bit, actually.
Part of it is right. Part of it is right where you're like, hey, listen, I got to get this out. But then all of a sudden, in the back of your mind, you're like, I've got nothing to hide from anybody. Nothing.
That's gotta
what's
feel
the
good.
Point? What's the point in hiding? Like literally, like when Me Too was happening, I was like, fuck, like is someone going to come out of the woodwork to say I did something wrong? Like what? And I literally called this girl that I went to like elementary school with. And I'm like, do you remember that time we kissed in the hedges? I'm really sorry if I like touched your boob and you didn't want me to. And she's like, shut the fuck up, you stupid idiot. Like it's totally fine. But I was like paranoid. So I think I believe in that whole thing that if your life is an open book, they can't get you. You know what I mean? They can't surprise you with nothing. So I'd rather just give it all.
Well, because what you've done is like you put it on Front Street and then you said, which is really the caveat here. It's like, I'm a work in progress. Like I'm going to get better. That's my goal. My goal is to get better every day. My goal is to evolve as a human being and look for happiness where sustainable happiness lives, right? It's not in drugs or alcohol.
Unless I lose my family, then I'm going out and I'm leaving Las Vegas meets mushrooms, acid, and cocaine.
And I will tag along.
Me too. Just for fun. Lie.
Good content, guys. Yeah. Wait, like, just get me in slow motion as I fly off the Caesars Hotel. You know, like, it'd be good. Someone's got to be on the bottom. We'll put Bonzi on the bottom.
It was funny because he wrote that on Saturday, and then I think you got really stoned. I think you smoked a huge blunt, and then you called.
I had mushroom tea.
Oh, did you? Okay. I can tell you were stoned. I can tell when you get a little tipsy. And my phone's ringing, and I'm like, it's Saturday night. I think I was watching a baseball game or something, and my phone's ringing, and I'm like, oh, this should be good. And
I love how I'm a punchline. Oh, there he is. Gilligan's on the line, everybody.
So I answer it. We get into it for about an hour. But James was calling because he ended that article by taking some shots at me. And he was worried. This is James to a T. So he fucking,
what does this say about me? You guys have to tell me because I can tell that you guys notice it and you're like, oh, there's that thing again. That
well, it's, Lachlan, get it's, over here. It's kind of doing. Endearing because you fucking spill your guts. Like that is it. That is a wildly revealing piece, right? And it's awesome. And I love it. And you had like you admitted at the beginning of this conversation that you had a moment where you were like, wow, is this too much? Ah, fuck it. Let's do it. But then what got to you was you shit talking me at the end of it. And you're like, oh, fuck.
Yeah.
It says a lot about your personality.
I did about like, I'm a possible sex addict, everybody. And then I was like, look, I'm sorry that I said you might not drink anymore.
I'm reading it thinking, what did he say? Like I read it the next day and I'm like, what the fuck did he say about me that he had to call me? And I'm like, what? It's fucking
well, let's
nothing.
Bring it up.
The guy let's just bring it. Shit bring it all up. Over himself for a,
sure, Sober James might still continue enough mushrooms to kill a Sasquatch, but here I am, one third of the most popular daily newscast in Canada. Yes, our version of the Daily News often comes with a side order of Lachlan's testicles and freakishly stretchable scrotum, but that's okay too. We are three grown-ass men with our finger on the pulse. That's hilarious. I can stretch it out over a bowl of salad and take it into a party. Profound immaturity, and it's fucking awesome to be part of it. Moreover, since Lachlan promised to stop drinking completely in 2022,
which is a lie,
to show where his oblivious alcoholism no longer derails an otherwise amazing show. Like, of all the things you wrote in there, that was the most revealing.
Yeah.
Like, we talk about it all the time.
I just remembered it was actually Dean. You asked me, you're like, you know what? You should write a piece about the I don't even remember what you wanted me to write it about, but I thought what you said was, hey, just slag me and Lachlan for 1,000 words. And I was like, yeah, okay, that'll be great. And I sent the first paragraph to Dean, and it was just like, just a horrible, just like crucifixion of Lachlan. And I was like, is this what you meant? And he's like, no.
That's I hope you would have saved, you should have saved that.
I think
I would have read it on the air.
I was reading it. I'm like, oh, this reads like he wants to murder Lachlan and me in our sleep. And then I'm like, hey, dude, might want to just like include how your life's changed since you've been doing this. And he's like, Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah.
Better idea.
And then,
better idea.
And then and all this, yeah. And by the way, much more though. Well received.
Click. Yeah.
Okay. I can read what I wrote about Lochlin because I sent it to you in a DM. It might be sort of.
Oh, we need music for this.
Yeah, you might. Okay, there it goes.
You want some I Hate Lochlin music for this? Yeah, fuck, no, I got no. it for you. Hang on a sec. What do you want? Do you want ambient, future pop, chill hop?
Maybe just like chill hop. Like loving.
I have a
like,
very you know? Dark sense of humor, so I may enjoy this immensely.
I haven't read this since I wrote this, so I don't know if there's like a bunch of typos and weird shit. I have a childhood friend who used to say things that were blatantly untrue in order to get a laugh. He was especially good at coming up with anecdotes about our friends, little bits of fiction designed to embarrass or demean, so he could then bask in the glory of getting all of us to laugh at something. I call them lie jokes. Turns out my buddy had all the makings of a standard morning show DJ for that archaic dying medium known as terrestrial radio. Speaking of Lachlan Cross, that lovable lumbering rabble rouser from 96.9 Cruise FM, an Edmonton radio station whose super awesome name is a tribute to the six people who like to cruise down Jasper Avenue, blasting a painfully predictable playlist that is interrupted every 3.5 minutes by car dealership ads and the obligatory station call sign. And then I sent that to Dean. He's like, I did.
I don't know where this is going.
Heavy. It's heavy. I said, this is heavy.
So yeah. So then I pivoted. I pivoted. So really, Dean, you're kind of like the first domino of the piece.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah. That's anyway. Good stuff.
I don't know what I'm doing.
Happy to be. Anyway, check it out. It's called Certain Soberish. James wrote it. It's absolutely fantastic. You'll love it. Especially if you're in a place in your life where you're taking you're starting to take the toll, right? Like, yeah, I should probably figure some stuff out. It was a really great read. So appreciate you, James.
Thanks, you know what I did?
It is really good.
I just wanted to say now, because I don't know if you guys ever experienced PTSD, but like I told my shrink about all this stuff. And he like a couple weeks ago was like, it sounds to me like you've had PTSD several times in your life and you never dealt with it. And I'm like, oh, okay. He's like, I'm like, you mean being ashtrays dumped on your head and having your stepmother put a knife to your throat? Is that going to cause this kind of shit? And he's like, yes, James. Like he was all serious about it. And I was kind of laughing. And he's like, laughing is how we mask our fears and everything. And I'm like, okay, give me my Adderall, you fucker.
Give me my Adderall, you fucker. Yeah, so Locke, you were right to start the show.
The therapy's going well, guys,
farming for drugs that he could get from the fucking doctor.
Hence the title of the piece.
It doesn't mean anything.
Soberish.
I'm going to write another piece about Adderall, I guess.
You know what, though? We need to get your shrink on the fucking show.
We should do that. Oh, my God. I should record the next phone thing that we have.
I think that might be illegal. Don't. Just cherry pick it.
Not if you get
permission. Slow his voice down.
Not if you get permission. It's not illegal. It's totally legal.
I'm trying to slow his voice down.
That's what we do to Jimmy.
That's a commit a crime.
Oh, hey, can I tell you guys a quick story?
Yes.
Yeah, sure. So,
no preamble.
Dean will relate to this. So every year, our company forces me to put together a best of tape and submit it to the Canadian Music Week for the radio show of the year, morning show of the year. Every company wants to win these awards. But the problem is it's the radio station companies that vote on them, right? So we're Harvard. We're 12 radio stations. And we're also not the easiest show to understand. Like a lot of people just don't get what it is. Like if I send my tape to somebody in Toronto and I want to just be in the room, a fly on the wall watching them listen to that fucking madness. And they're like, what is this shit? Like,
I really don't think we can manage him. We can't manage him.
We're never going to win this award. So it drives me crazy that I got to waste my time doing this every year. And we just had a one of the managers leave. That was part of the reason why we had to do it every year. And I'm like, hey, so-and-so's gone. Can we not do these fucking tapes anymore? And he's like, no, the other guy wants them now too. And then the boss goes, we should send this. And I shit on my boss quite a bit, but to his face, but I got to give him some credit for this. He goes, maybe we should send them James P. White's solo show, which we got him a year ago. He does it Saturday and Sunday nights, midnight to 2 a.m. It's a voice track. And I talked to Boston to letting him do it to build his confidence as a broadcaster. And Jimmy, if you know Jimmy, takes it very seriously. And he's awful. He's probably the worst fucking announcer I've ever heard on the air by himself. But we leave him on there every midnight, every Saturday and Sunday at midnight. And occasionally we'll cut breaks out of it. And then to make matters worse, I time pitch it and I slow it down. So he sounds like he's drunk. And we play those bits on the air. We do like James P. White Experience sound checks, our air checks live on the show all the time. But he also has one of these interviews with Rick Nielsen, which I've told you guys about from Cheap Trick.
We played it on the air. Yeah.
I couldn't finish listening. I felt so painful and
it's
bad.
It's one of the worst interviews I have ever heard. And I work with the guy. It's fucking amazing.
It's
so
terrible.
This year, for our CMW fucking
I haven't heard the album.
Air check, we're going to send Slowed Down Jimmy.
That was awesome. That was awesome. That remember that thing? That was awesome. Cheap Trick.
Dude, those awards are such horseshit. You know,
oh my God.
You know, like every year they change. They're like they're between three companies, two or three companies, and every year they rotate between who wins the award, and it's all kangaroo court. Like whoever wins broadcaster of the year, according to CMW, might as well just fucking quit the business because you're fucking useless. The only reason why you got the award is because the other business won it last year and it was your turn. That's literally all that's about.
Exactly.
We stopped submitting. Like we were nominated one year. I think the first year was in Toronto. And I'm like, don't submit to those fucking idiots. Why are we trying to have our peers who are trying to kick the shit out of every year on air? Why are we having them judge our stuff? It's ridiculous. The radio awards are a joke.
No, I knew you'd be on side with that. But I am. Oh, yeah. I am now. I'm excited about applying though this year with Slowed Down Jimmy.
Change your mind. That's it for us. Lachlan Cross, James DiFiore. You can find Lachlan at 95.7 Cruise FM, not 96.9, as James said in his piece. It's 95.7 Cruise FM in Edmonton.
I have a good excuse. I've never listened to Lachlan on the radio.
Well, and you're
high. I've listened to him online.
That's good. You can also find Lachlan at 95.7 or just on the Twitter machine at Lachlan Cross. James DiFiore is a wonderful journalist. Blackballmedia.ca is where you can find him and everything he does. You can also find his podcast called Blackball the Podcast, wherever you get your podcasts, including DeanBlundell.com.
And don't send me drugs, guys.
We should repost that article he did. It's really good, everybody. It really is. It's really good. All right.
Yeah, it is. It's awesome.
And when are my nut huggers showing up? Thanks, when are the nut huggers showing up?
Next week.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
One of our major sponsors. Next week.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah.
Edsfineimports.com.
What size did you get?
I got you both larges.
But has the
What's the waist size on that? I want to make sure they fit.
I'm going to need a belt because my waist is 31.
32 to 34.
That's
medium.
Large
is
38.
I'm more of a 36.
You're more of a 36 now? Oh, you lied to start the show. You said you were 34 with an extra big package, I believe, was exactly what you said.
I want to be the guy with the I'm a medium. I'm a medium split toe. What does that work out to?
You're going to put on the gitch, and everyone's going to be like, I think there's a glitch in your gitch.
If they're smaller, my package will look bigger.
It's true.
I'll send him to you.
And I don't need to worry about blood flow down there anymore.
No, you're good. Yeah.
Now that you're breathing through
it takes a village. Takes a village to raise that thing. Locke, good for you. Congratulations.
That was fun today, guys. All right.
Appreciate
you. All right. James and Lachlan, you can find them where we told you to find them. Thank you very much, fellas. Have a great day. That's it for me. Thanks for watching. Thanks for being part of the show. Don't forget our sponsor at Ed's Fine Imports. Use promo code GITCH3. I'll send you four pairs for the price of three. Go to edsfineimports.com. Luxury branded underwear. You'll love it. Also, want to thank our friends over at Easy Auto Financial. Easy Auto Financial gets you in a car. Doesn't matter what your credit rating looks like. They take all the guesswork out. Doesn't cost you a dime. Pre-approved like this. They'll also send you to find the car and the car that you want. They'll hook everything up. It's so easy. Turnkey to buy a vehicle. Go to easyautofinancial.ca. Try them out today. Also, our friends over at Blue Microphones. Appreciate you guys. They've set up the entire network now, 74, 75 podcasts strong. I can't remember. I just did the marketing meeting today. I think I know. But listen, we appreciate our friends at Blue. They're the best company in the world to be able to set this kind of stuff up. Logitech group of companies. If you're a podcaster, broadcaster, check out everything that they have, all their wares at bluemike.com. Or check them out on Twitter as well. And then you can find your way to their website in their bio. Just go to at Blue Microphones. Super easy. We use the Blue Yeti X because it's an XLR, not an XLR. It's a USB mic. So it takes all the baloney out of the fucking work process, which is incredible. It's got a preamp in it. And the MoFi headphones, you can use anything you want. They've got headsets. They've got everything. Go to bluemike.com or at Blue Microphones on Twitter, deanblundell.com, part of the Blue crew. That's it for us. Domination. Didn't say hi to our friends at Domination. AI for people that produce content. Go to domination.com, DMNTN.com. Try them for free today. Have a great day, everybody. Thanks so much for watching. Don't forget to sign up for a newsletter at DeanBlundell.com. That'd be great because then you can kind of pick and choose a la carte, whatever the stuff it is that you want, what you want to get. Be safe. Be kind.
-1 minute.